Hello and welcome to Outlooks, The Outlier. This is the show where we get top names from the fields of politics, economics, academia, sports, science, literature, the arts, and so on. But the people who feature in the show do not only excel in their fields, but are much more than that. They are the true trailblazers. They are the trendsetters. You know, they are a true inspiration to a younger generation. Our outlier this week is best-selling author Amish. Amish, for the first 14 years of his career, was a boring banker. Then divine intervention took place, and he was always interested in mythologies, and he wrote the book, The Immortals of Meluha, the first book in the Shiva trilogy. This became an overnight bestseller, and Amish was an instant hit. The Shiva trilogy, in fact, is the fastest selling book series in the Indian publishing history. Soon he started with his Ramachandra series, which turned out to be, well, the second fastest selling book series in Indian publishing. There are over 5 million copies of Amish's books in print today. And he's just come out with his new book, Suhaildev, The King Who Saved India. Amish also took over as the head of the Nehru Center in London earlier this year. Hello, Amish. Thank you very much for joining The Outlier.
Thank you, Satish. Always a pleasure to meet you here.
Always a delight to speak to you too. I wanted to actually begin by asking, so you just took over as the head of the Nehru Center in London, you know, when the coronavirus pandemic broke. So how has it been for you to be away from friends, away from the family, in a new foreign city?
Actually, in things like this, you realize some things about yourself in situations like this. I always thought I was a loner. And you know that. I don't really go to too many parties. Even if I go to Litfest, I normally go just for my day and I leave. I normally don't hang around for the full 4 or 5 days. So I always thought I was a loner, right? But I think in this last 3 or 4 months, I have realized the difference between being a loner and a monk. A loner only means that you'll have a limited social circle, right? Maybe close friends and family, that's it. But it doesn't mean that you're a monk. It doesn't mean that you have no social circle.
Yes.
And I'm stuck all by myself out here completely alone in a cold, unfamiliar city. It's a time for reflection. The most difficult part is, this is the longest I haven't seen my son. I have not seen him now for 4 months and 3 days now.
That's so tough.
It's damn tough, yeah. And he's the love of my life. And you can have as many video calls as you want. It's not the same thing. That's the most difficult part, of course. But we are where we are. Yeah. In a sense, both you and I, we are privileged. This is the worst that we are suffering. Many are suffering a lot worse across the world.
Yes, absolutely,
I guess one has to have a sense of perspective and this life, we have to live how we have to live.
And many congratulations on your new book, Suhaildev, which we can see at the on your background there. It's prominently displayed.
Never lose a marketing opportunity.
So, this say somebody like Suhaildev, this character, who's as you say in the book, is a king who saved India. And he's a king from the 11th century who fights the Muhammad of Ghazni. So we've all learned a lot about Muhammad of Ghazni, in our history books, elsewhere. But people like this Suhaildev, one has really never heard of. So how much is he fiction? How much is he fact?
This question of fiction and fact often emerges from the perspective of the person analyzing, often. There has been an establishment historian view that privileges texts over oral traditions. And it's not that India did not have texts. India has over 3 million, as the National Mission of Manuscript has tabulated, over 3 million handwritten non-printing press manuscripts. That's more than the rest of the ancient world combined. But India was always a culture which privileged oral traditions over the written text. is that lovely line, Shastrat Rudir Valyasi, that folk traditions are more important, more powerful than the texts. And this is, there is a rethinking among historians, certainly in the West, it hasn't reached India as yet. There is a rethinking among historians, certainly in the West, that you have to give folk traditions respect as well to find out what history could be. You shouldn't privilege only texts. Because, for example, if you privileged only texts, how much textual evidence is there of, say, Alfred the Great, for example, or his son, the elder? How much? Most of it is actually oral, right? Their traditions. But they are considered, the among the greatest Anglo-Saxon kings in British history. Now, a lot of it is based on oral tradition, right? So it has, in the West, they have started accepting this, that that we have to look at oral traditions as well, not just texts. So in India, and especially in this last millennium, look, history is written by the victors, right? Yes. The texts that were written over the last 1,000 years often privileged the invaders over the defenders. And perhaps there is a time for even Indian historians to start learning the attitudes of the West, which looks at folk traditions or folk tales or older traditions as well, to try to find what history could be there. Like I said, perfect example, Alfred the Great. I'm in the UK right now. Alfred the Great is, the king of Wessex. He's considered the first Anglo-Saxon king. He gave rise to the concept of England. Now, how much written records are there? And they don't dismiss that out of hand. So it's the same thing with King Suhaildev as well. There are strong oral traditions.
So in this case, of Suhaildev, the oral traditions, you went and researched them, how did the story come about? How did you put, see, that is what I mean, that how much of it is your imagination and how much of it could have happened?
Oh, no, I should clarify that nowhere do the Immortal Writers Center, nowhere do we claim this is the truth. We are not scholars. I'm not a scholar.
Yeah, it is not a history book.
Yeah. I'm a storyteller. So this is fiction. I make that very clear. Storytellers tell stories and scholars write history. And we have to do our respective jobs. Shreya Swadharma Vegunaha Swara Dharma Swanasruta. We should do what our Swadharma is rather than doing someone else's job. It's not a storyteller's job to be a scholar. It's not a scholar's job to be a storyteller. He or she should focus on texts and on evidence. And a storyteller is often driven, and at least someone like as I am, you've known me for a few years, I'm driven a lot by what is the core philosophy that I want to convey through this book. Shiva trilogy had its own core philosophy. The Ramchandra series had its own core philosophy. One of the things that has struck me as I wrote, as one worked more and more on Suhaildev, that he is a very, very important, his story is a very important story as a message of unity, which I think is particularly relevant today. I think his message kind of reaches across the chasm of time to today and delivers a message which is very critical.
Mm-hmm.
How is it that Indians, who were considered an unconquerable country in the first millennium common era, became a country that was repeatedly conquered in the second millennium common era? One of the things that I feel is that our internal divisions did us in often. And is this a message that we need to learn, especially today as well? We are facing threats from outside India. And one of the lessons that Suhaildev's story teaches us is that if we Indians are united, we are usually unbeatable. But the sad truth is often we are divided more than united. And is there a story which can be an inspiration for this time? Can we be united? And for me, Suhail Dev's story really fit that bill.
So do you think, you know, there are many, there may be many characters like him in, you know, in our past, you know, this of course, in Somnath, you know, elsewhere in the country too. And we don't teach too much about them to our children. You know, do you sometimes feel that we are not that proud of our past?
Satish, I agree with you. You know, there is there's an economist and a, you know, and well, he writes history books as well. Sanjeev Sanyal, who made this very interesting statement that the history we are taught is often the history of our invaders rather than the history of us, right? And I think I genuinely believe one of the key mistakes our establishment historians made, you know, was they don't call the British colonial rule the Christian rule. So why do we call the Turkic colonial rule the Islamic rule? You know? And I think that terminology itself has created a lot of poison. And often popular culture has aided that, you know. So in the Indian popular mind, you know, Alauddin Khilji is seen as Ranbir Singh, you know, mm-hmm. or Akbar is seen as Prithviraj Kapoor. They were actually Turkic, you know? So to us, to the Indian eyes, they would have actually looked Chinese to us, you know.
Yeah.
And you realize that in popular culture, when we show British rule, we're very conscious that we'll show a white-skinned guy, you know. We show Tom Walter, you know.
Yes.
Tom Walter was the hapless guy who was usually cast, you know, as the evil British, you know, ruler. But when we see the Turkic colonial rulers, they normally put Indian actors out there. In the back of the mind, it's like, they were Indian Muslims. No, they were not. They were Turks. They were foreigners. And to the Indian eyes, they would have looked Chinese. The Chinese would have been able to differentiate them, of course, because the Turks were from Central Asia. And the Turks didn't just conquer and devastated India. They conquered and devastated the Arab world as well. They conquered and devastated much of Eastern Europe, went up to Central Europe as well. They were the foot soldiers of the Mongols who conquered and devastated China. So, from the 11th to the 16th to the 17th century, the Turks were the superpower, the global superpower.
Yeah.
Because the world has not seen a conquering race like them ever. They were brutal beyond measure.
You know? Yes, plunderers. I mean,
Timurid, for example, killed 5%. Timur, he killed 5% of the, he was a Turk. He killed 5% of the world's population. At a time when it wasn't easy to kill 5% of the world's population, because there were no weapons of mass destruction, there were no nuclear bombs, there's no dynamite. You had to behead, stab, you had to do it the hard way. And he killed 5% of the world's population. Now, these guys attacked us as well. Not just Arabia or Eastern Europe or China. But in our popular culture, they have been shown as Indians. Our history books call them the Islamic invaders, you know. Well, the Islamic invaders conquered the Arab world as well, boss. Who destroyed the Abbasid caliphate? It was Mongols and Turks. And I think this has, in effect, added a lot of poison to our body politic.
Yes.
And King Suhail Dev, in my mind, is such an inspiring figure to bring up this story. Because the way our history is taught to us is Mahmud Ghazni came, invaded India 70 times, and almost seamlessly, the way history has been taught to us, almost seamlessly, Mohammad Ghori came, right? And the so-called Islamic rule began. But in actual fact, Mahmud Ghazni came in the 1020s. Mohammad Ghori came in 1190. That's a very long time, 160 years. No Turkic invader came back to India. This at a time when they were conquering much of the rest of the known world. Why didn't they come back to India? The answer was King Suhail Dev and the Battle of Bahraich, where he defeated and killed them down to the last man. Right? It is such an inspiring story. And he was, he made tremendous sacrifices. And of course, this is you know, many of the folk traditions have contradictions as well. So, and like I'm saying, I don't claim this is a scholarly history, and I'm hoping that this will hopefully, you know, this will hopefully trigger interest, and we will study great heroes like King Suhaildev, who we need to study. But he united Indians of all religions, all castes, communities, and forged an army, you know, and defended the motherland. Such an inspiring story. We must learn it.
It is, I mean, the surprising fact is, you know, such a character is not even really a postscript in any of our, you know, I think most people, unless you're a history scholar, maybe, wouldn't have even heard of him.
No, Satish, one of my complaints with many of our establishment historians, besides the fact that many of them write very boring books on such an interesting subject, Indian history is dramatic, but, you know, they have to learn the art of how to write a book which engages as well. Western historians do it so well, man. You know, to make it scholarly, you don't have to make it boring and a cure for insomnia. That's a separate quibble. That's a minor quibble. The major quibble with them is an obsessive focus on Delhi. Right? And I've got nothing against Delhi. You know, it is a very important city for India, but there are other parts of India as well.
Yes. You know?
South India, Western India, Eastern India, frankly, even Gangetic Plains, unless it was a part of Delhi, been largely ignored. You know, the Palas, whose empire was as big as Akbar's, you know, has been ignored. The greatest empire India ever had was Maurya's. You know, their biggest territory, understandable. Okay, so they can't be ignored. But the Palas, a Buddhist empire based out of Bengal, completely ignored. Their empire was as big as Akbar. The Cholas, Rajen Chola had an empire which was bigger than Akbar's, frankly, in terms of population, because he had all of South India, East India, most of Southeast Asia. Bay of Bengal was Rajen Chola's pond. But he's reduced to just a few lines in our national history books.
Right.
You know, the Gurjar Pratiharas, Guptas outside of Vikramaditya, you know, many of the, you know, you could say the Chola Empire, Gurjar Pratiharas could probably have been bigger than the Gupta Empire. Why the Gurjar Pratiharas ignored? Why is Raja Bhoj ignored? You know, why are the Ahoms ignored? You know, they never lost a battle for 800 years. How come you notice all our invaders came only from the northwest, not from the northeast? Because the Pashtuns kept losing battles. But the Ahoms never lost a battle. So invaders never came from the northeast. But Ahoms are completely ignored from Assam. You know, Marathas, let's be honest, till Sanjay Leela Bhansali came up with his movie, let's be honest, if we put a hand on our heart, how many people outside Maharashtra knew the extent of the Maratha Empire? The way the history is taught to us is the British conquered India from the Mughals, which is not true. They conquered it from the Marathas, actually. Right? So, the Adil Shahis of Maharashtra, they are completely ignored. There's an obsessive Delhi focus, which is unfair. And that needs to be balanced. So, we Indians, for example, think of ourselves as a very land and agriculture-focused civilization because of the way history is taught to us with this obsessive Delhi focus. But actually, if you go to Western, Eastern, Southern India, we were among the greatest seafaring nations in the world. But that part is completely ignored. You know, in the Mauryan Guptan times, of course, we had, yes, the Mughals weren't great seafarers, but the Mauryas and Guptas, the other great empires, were great seafarers. That's not covered. So, I think a lot of it comes from a bias towards Delhi, which needs to be balanced. Once again, I'm not anti-Delhi. It is an important city. It must be covered. But let's show the other parts of India too. Let's get a holistic understanding of India. King Muktipeeda Lalitaditya, for example, of Kashmir. He ruled most of India. Been ignored completely. He's not even mentioned in our history books.
You know, the other problem, I think, Amish, is also, you know, when of late, you know, this history and mythology, I mean, you know, it's a mixture of, you know, where history ends and mythology begins. It's anyway a tough thing to understand. I mean, you know, like, for instance, when outlandish claims like, you know, we had missile technology during Mahabharata, or, you know, there was plastic surgery for Ganesha, things like that. So that is when, you know, it, I think, starts to go a bit, sort of, it, you know, starts to look bizarre. or shall I say, it starts to look, you know, forced and as if, you know, I mean, when there was so much actually going on, as you are mentioning, in real, why create this outlandish kind of a scenario?
Satish, the way I see it, fantasies prosper in an atmosphere of ignorance. You know, if you're not teaching the real truths, about India, then people will look for fantasies and start believing them. Did we have missiles in India? No, there's no evidence of that in ancient India. There's no evidence of that. But you know, there was a science conference in the UK, an Indian history of Indian science exhibition in the UK, okay, mm-hmm. that had been organized, which explored the achievements of ancient Indian scientists. And sadly, it didn't travel to India, you know, because I think it would have been a shock to many Indians to see those things.
Uh-huh.
So, for example, I'm not so sure about, you know, I mean, where claims were made about plastic surgery. But the fact that plastic surgery nose reconstruction was practiced in India has actually been accepted by many Western scientists. Because the exact technique of almost, you know, the base technique that is used for rhinoplasty in modern surgery is described in Shushrut's and Charak's texts in ancient India. And those have been decoded in the Bower manuscripts. They are called Bower because a British guy called Bower discovered them, I think 100 or 150 years ago or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then those have been analyzed in the UK.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a magazine called Gentleman, a British magazine, which recorded a barber carrying out a nose reconstruction surgery on a soldier of the Maratha army around 160 or 170 years ago, witnessed by two British officers. And they recorded it in the Gentleman magazine. And the technique used by that barber was the exact technique that was described in Shushrut and Charak's texts. Now, this was eye-opening. I read a lot, you know, but I didn't know this, you know. And so you see, like Bodhayana, for example, he discovered the Pythagoras theorem before Pythagoras did. In the Shulba Sutra, it was written 200 years before Pythagoras even lived. But we don't know these facts, you know. So we should be taught these facts. So then those fantasies will not exist. The greatest, the greatest disinfectant is always sunshine, right? Is always sunlight. Let the light of knowledge spread. But the fault is, honestly, I think, of our academia and our scholars, that they have not studied and shared these things. There could be various reasons. It could be perhaps they have a bias against ancient India. They don't want to study it. That could be one reason. Second, much to my surprise, I discovered many of our scholars who've written our history books actually don't know a word of Sanskrit. So they are themselves dependent on translations which the British did. So if they can't read the primary text, obviously they're, you know, the textbooks they write will not be, you know, it's as bizarre as someone writing the seminal French history books without knowing a word of French. Obviously, you know. So I think we need more scholars. We need the academia to research our texts. And the texts are there. The National Mission of Manuscripts has tabulated 3 million manuscripts, more than the rest of the ancient world combined. So it's a fallacy. It's wrong to say that Indians did not write. It's not true. Indians privileged oral traditions over the texts. That I agree. But we have more ancient texts than the rest of the ancient world combined. We need to study it. You know? And it'll be good. And you know, and I don't, this debate is beyond the left and right silliness. I think this study will help everyone, including the 90% of us who are in the center, who are calm, reasoned, centrist people, mm-hmm. who are liberal, but have, of course, a sense of pride in our country as well.
Yes.
And we are not scholars, we are storytellers. Our scholars need to do this work. Yes. And they need to share it.
You know, Amish, you did an MBA. You were a banker for 14 years of your career. How did you get into all this? How did you, I mean, how do you know so much about, you know,
How did this happen? I mean, was it always simultaneously you were interested, or I mean, how did you get into this area?
From a young age, man. I've been reading, obsessively from a young age, and I can't say I'm unique in my family. I would say I'm the dumbest guy in my family. Thank you. In my family, everyone reads obsessively. Both my parents read a lot. So that is the atmosphere of our family. Much of our traditions, the spiritual traditions, I've learned from my family. But much of my knowledge of history is just reading. You know, I love reading. I read at least 5-6 books a month.
And Sanskrit?
I've been reading at that pace for decades. So I guess all that knowledge goes somewhere in my mind. One of my favorite genres to read is actually, you know, history. I'm not talking about historical fiction. I'm talking about pure history books. Scientific texts, even science journals. I love reading them.
Okay.
Politics, economics. I read more non-fiction than fiction.
Mm-hmm. And you know, this enduring attraction of mythologies, you know, it's young, old, you know, literate, illiterate, rural, urban. It just sort of, everybody's so fascinated by it. What is this? Where does that fascination come from?
Wonderful question, yeah, Sadish. I think I'd read this line somewhere. I don't know who had said it, and I've myself quoted it a few times, that no Indian hears the Ramayana for the first time. We're just born with it. You know?
Yeah, that's true.
And that's true of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which is actually the entry level, because we are not a people of the book, and in the dharmic way, I'm saying. We are more a people of a library, right? And Ramayana and Mahabharata are the entry level. It's the first time. And we are such an ancient culture. You know, we are the only pre-Bronze Age culture that is a living culture till today. We are surviving till today. Every other pre-Bronze Age culture has died out. Many of them violently, many of them themselves through exhaustion, whatever, they died out. We are still here. We are still, you know, chanting hymns that were written thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. I'm a Shaivite. Many Shaivites still today, chant the Shri Rudram, you know, which is written in the Vedas thousands and thousands and thousands of years ago. Many Vaishnavs still chant the Purushukta, you know. When was it written? It's from the Rig Veda. It would have been composed even earlier.
True.
Many of the rituals we practice, I think things have almost, you know, without us realizing it, they are part of our genetic memory. They are part of, because it is so ancient, you know, and I genuinely believe this is the heritage of every person who is in the Indian subcontinent, regardless of religion, regardless of community background, regardless of language spoken. This is the heritage of all of us, because all of us have inherited it in our genes, which is why you'll find, I mean, even 35 years later, the Ramayana is retelecast, okay, in India. Yeah. And we all know the production qualities aren't that good. They didn't have budgets at that time. It gets a higher viewership than Game of Thrones got all over the world. Just from India, it is, and it's the power of the story, our deep attachment, you know, to these stories. And it's not just Hindus watching them, you know, it's Muslims, Christians, Hindus, Jains, Parsis, all of us, because it is a collective heritage, right? And I think in some ways it's so beautiful, you know, it really, I think it binds all of us together. It's one of the things that makes me deeply emotional.
Yes. Amish, tell us a little bit about this writer's center that you've started. You know, this book, this Suhail Dev, is a product of that, you've said. So what is it? There is a team of researchers who go out and sort of do the research and you do the writing. Is that right? How does that work?
Yeah, you know how it works, Adi. One of my biggest fears in life is I will die before I finish all my story ideas that I already have. Right? Huh. Lord Shiva has blessed me with too many stories. And at the pace that I write, I can't write quicker than a year and a half to 2 years. My books are long. They are detailed. It's 400, 500 pages. It takes time to write. I can't write quicker than a year and a half to 2 years. And at this pace, I will die before I finish all the story ideas I already have. And no, I keep getting blessed with more. You know, I got another story idea in London. So there was an idea that was given to me that, you know, because that's my biggest fear. I don't want to carry it to my cremation pyre. I want to get all my stories out. So there's an idea given to me that how about if we start a writer center? This has been done in the West. It's never been done in India.
Right. That's right.
I'm a bit of a control freak. So the way it has been, the system has been designed out here, is that I kind of communicate and write a short story summary, maybe 5,000, 10,000 words, and I share it with writers in the writer center. And I tell them what research they should, do. I have a research, assistant as well, someone who knows Sanskrit, who helps me. And then the writer center writer kind of, they work on this and make the first draft, right, of the book, which would be 60,000, 70,000 words. Then that is given to me and then I work on it. Create the second draft and then finalize the manuscript.
Mm-hmm.
As far as a reader is concerned, it will read just like my book. Right? Okay. I don't know if you've had the chance to read Suhail Deves yet.
I've gone through parts of it, yes.
Yeah. You have, it'll read like any of my books. It's essentially the Genesis and the writing second and the finalization is by me.
Mm.
But what bringing in a writer center does is it expands my capacity. I can bring out books quicker.
Yeah, but it's good that you've said it up front. I mean,
That I'm very clear on. I don't want to mislead readers by them thinking that this is solely my work. No, it's not. You know, the Shiva trilogy, Ramchandra series is solely my work. Only I write. Only I do research. I do everything in that, right?
Okay.
But this, I don't want to mislead. Make it clear that this is, it's a joint product.
Okay. Okay. And now, we were discussing this such a, wonderful character. Would you like to read a couple of pages, since the book has just got released? To our viewers, to give a sample of what's in it.
First, got a copy here. This is the cover. Not that you'll miss it because it's here also.
Yes.
Never miss a marketing opportunity.
Rather prominently placed there is.
Okay, so let me just give you a background to the scene that I'm going to read.
Okay.
So King Suheldev essentially first leads a resistance movement against the invaders, against the Turks, and keeps harassing them till it finally culminates into a great battle, the Battle of Bahraj, right? And he puts his band together and starts harassing the Turks, in various different parts because the Turkic army had already invaded India. And as I said, King Suheldev has followers from, from all castes and communities. Backward castes, Kshatriyas, Muslims, Buddhists, from all communities. One of his Indian Muslim followers is a soldier called Abdul. Right? What happens is because King Suheldev is a very practical warrior. He's a lot like how, think Chhatrapati Shivaji, right? So, he's about that, stay focused, fight in a calculating, cold, calm manner, no hot-blooded vengeance, cold, calm retribution, cold, ruthless retribution. That's what we'll do. So, that was his warrior style. Shate Shatyam Samachare. Dushke sa dushrata hi karni chahiye. He has that kind of attitude, that dharmic with those who behave with honor, but those who don't, he will attack ruthlessly, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which was how the Turks used to battle.
Mm.
So what happened was that they were at a war camp, and Abdul and another soldier had gone out to to do some trade with some villagers. And they discovered that a Turkic raiding party had attacked that village. And they were raiding the temple to steal the gold and the idol from there. And this is after Somnath Ji has been destroyed already.
That's what I was. Where does the scene take place?
Yeah. So Somnath Ji has been destroyed already. So this is in what would be modern UP. So this is after that, when King Sohildeva started his resistance. And Abdul's colleague who's out there, who's not Muslim, says we should go back and get King Sohildev and come back and fight. And Abdul says by that time the idol itself may be destroyed. So he tells, because he's feeling that he has to do something. That's what Abdul feels. And so he tells his colleague, you go back, find King Sohildev. I will go and delay and try and fight. Abdul does that. He gets captured. The Turks catch him. They assume, you know, he is an Indian Hindu. They start torturing him and then they discover he's a Muslim. Right. And they get angry with him. Like, how can you go against us? And he says, I'm fighting with my Indians, my fellow Indians against you. So he gets tortured, nearly close to death, when Sohildev and his soldiers arrive to save him.
Okay.
And Abdul is saved. And he has been, the physician has worked on him. He's been unconscious for most of the day. Okay. And Sohildev has come to talk to him. That's the scene.
Okay.
Abdul opened his eyes. Every part of his body ached, like each cell had been thrown into a hurricane, whiplashed for an eon, and then stitched back together into a devastated body. He heard the voice he recognized well. You'll recover soon. Abdul tried to rise. Suhail. Sohildev gently pushed Abdul back onto the bed. Stay on your back. How long have I? Almost an entire day. Sohildev and his men were still in the village and they intended to remain there till Abdul recovered. The villagers were busy cleaning up the remnants of the battle, repairing their homes, restoring the village temple, removing all traces of the bodies of the king's men. They would pretend that Salik was the Turk, that Salik and his soldiers had left the village with their booty and that they had no idea where Salik went after that. Is the temple safe? Asked Abdul. Still weak from the severe beating he'd received from Salik and his men the previous night. But his mind was alert. The local medicine man was good. Sohildev ignored the question. He spoke firmly. Don't do this again. Sohildev, I know what you're trying to do. You don't need to prove anything. Don't do this again. But that Turk, the temple idols, we will make new idols. Abdul remained silent. Sohildev continued, our faith is our strength. But the Turks have turned our faith into our weakness. They know that we will go to any extent to protect our idols, even sacrifice our lives. And they use that as a pressure tactic to break our resolve, to defeat us easily. But listen to me. It's my faith. I know. The divine is everywhere. In the stars and the skies, in the trees, in the rivers, in the wind, in all of us. Our faith is what actually puts God himself into an idol. If we all die, then our faith dies as well. If our faith dies, then who will worship the idols? Remember, new idols can always be made and pran pratishtha done on them. But if our faith dies, then it is all over. And our faith exists only in our beating hearts. So if there's a choice between saving an idol or us, I will always choose us. Abdul looked away, a soft tear rolling down his cheek. You don't understand. It was Sohildev's turn to remain silent. He let Abdul speak. Abdul's tears picked up pace. I feel guilty. I had to do something. I had to fight. Suheldev answered, "You have nothing to feel guilty about. You have nothing to do with the Turks or the crimes they commit." Abdul turned back towards Suheldev. Suheldev's voice quivered slightly, his strong emotions bursting through. "You're not one of them. You're one of us." Abdul's tears flowed quicker. Suheldev held Abdul's hand firmly. "You're one of us. I trust you completely. I want you to fight by my side, but the aim of fighting a battle is to win, not to become a martyr." Abdul remained quiet. "Remember what I told you earlier, what I learned from Baba, what I learned that day of the attack on the Ghazni envoy. No angry vengeance. We will have cold, ruthless retribution." Abdul looked at Suheldev with respect. Till now, he had shown the prince respect only for his birth. But now, he respected him for the man that he was becoming, the leader that he was becoming. Abdul whispered, "Yes, my lord." Suheldev smiled and touched Abdul's shoulder. "Continue to call me Suheldev." Abdul shook his head. "No, my lord."
Very nice. Very interesting. Very interesting. Thank you very much, Amish, for joining the Outlier. All the best with your new book. I'm sure it will be as big a success as all your other books.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for joining the Outlier.
Thank you. My pleasure.